Be seated, please. Today, I especially greet the church here, and I greet all the saints here today, Sister Lisa. Special greetings again to Brother Jones. We miss you, man, and we're happy to see you. And we wish you were standing in my space. But that time will come. All right, let us turn our Bibles briefly to Luke 14. St. Luke 14. And we'll be reading from the 16th verse. St. Luke 14 from the 16th verse. And I'll be going through some other passages as the Lord would take me, as the case might be. Then said he unto him, a certain man made a great supper and bade many, and sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden, come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make excuse. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I pray must need to go and see it. If I pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I have go to prove them. I pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and shew his lord these things, that the master of the house bring angry, saying to his servant and lanes of the city, he said, go to the streets, go quickly into the streets and lanes of the city. Bring in hither the poor and the maimed and the halt on the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. And the Lord said unto the servant, go out into the highways and hedges, compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say unto you that none of these men were bidden shall taste of my supper. And today, as we look into this word, I'll be speaking on the topic discipleship. Discipleship. As we, as a mankind, as a human race, have been enslaved by sin, today we have an opportunity to be emancipated or liberated from sin. Freedom, once again, is in sight through the Lord Jesus Christ. When we look at the word disciple from the concise dictionary, it defines a disciple to be one who accepts and assists in spreading the doctrine of another, such as Christianity, or one of the 12 in the inner circles of Jesus Christ's followers, according to the Synoptic Gospels account, which is Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And as it says here in St. John chapter 1, verse 32 to 34, and John bear record saying, I saw the Spirit descended from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. So here, John the Baptist have been baptizing people on the move. From city to city, he was baptizing folk. But it was told to him that he was just a servant preparing for a greater one. And the people started, because here we have the scribes, Pharisees, and hypocrites. They were in the beginning with Jesus. Everything to do with faith and Christianity, they were in the mood for it. They were on point with what was happening in John's religion, so to speak. And so they asked John the Baptist, are you the Christ? And he said, I am not the Christ, but one that cometh greater than I. That's the one I am waiting for. And every time John the Baptist would baptize somebody, he was waiting for the sign. Because he wanted to know for himself that he is serving the right God. It is important for you to know what kind of a church are you in. Am I in the right church? Am I serving the right God? It's important to know that I am not serving somebody that is not appropriate, so to speak. And when John the Baptist met Jesus, he met Jesus at baptism. And Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, and after when he was baptized, a dove came over him, and John the Baptist said it was not like just any dove, but it was the Spirit. It was a special covering. It was a special thing that I saw that I could not even handle when I saw it. And he said in verse 33, and I knew him not. But he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaineth on him. So, Lord of mercy, so the Spirit of God did not just came on Jesus, but it remained on him. Hallelujah. That's the kind of thing that I am speaking about. You are going to leave here today with this thing stay on you, because you're going to understand who you are. You're going to understand discipleship and what it means to the New Testament church. And so John the Baptist says, the same is he which baptizeth with the Holy Ghost. So John the Baptist say, anytime you come in contact with Jesus, you are meeting somebody, amen, that fills you with the Holy Ghost and fire. All through the years in college, I have studied, amen, all kinds of different philosophies. Yes, I've read of Buddha, but it didn't say of the all talking about the 6 million and all the different gods they have, or the 600 different gods they serve, and all the different numbers. And I look at the numbers, it's so outrageous of the different gods they have. But it didn't say Buddha baptized anyone with the Holy Ghost and fire. Oh, we read of Muhammad. We read of all kinds of Anna Krishna, all the different God, God of Sue, and all the different gods that we have read of. We didn't hear of the moon god or a sun god or any of them, amen, given the Holy Ghost and fire. Not only that, in the days of Jesus, none of these men was ever been raised up or amplified or been spoken about. Muhammad came into being in the 500s, AD, so he was not in this movement as we speak. But the Bible says that John bear witness of these things. It was not only that John saw it, but Nathaniel saw it also. There was another disciples. Amen. When they heard of Jesus, when they heard that he was on the scene, the Bible says that when they came in contact with him, they knew that he was, amen, God all by himself, so to speak. And the Bible said that John uttered from his mouth, "Behold the Lamb of God," and immediately, without any reservation, without any hesitation, two disciples heard him speak. And they just followed him. Hallelujah, Jesus. You see, I imagine if I heard that Jesus was over by the Braves Stadium, oh Lord have mercy, I would begin to speak in tongues right now. I don't even want to drive my car. I would make it by foot over to see Jesus. That's the kind of spirit and determination Christians have to have when it comes to talking about Jesus. Although many people acclaim to be followers of Jesus Christ, their lifestyle is not measuring up. Amen. It is astonishing to see, amen, in the lost for words, the things that Christians who have called followers of Jesus Christ have been doing. And not only that, many people who have called themselves Christian, they have not yet proved the authenticity of who Jesus is. And today this sermon is to let you know what Jesus expects of you as a disciple. Because when you understand discipleship, it will help you to have a clearer understanding of how to serve who you're talking about. Since a disciple can be taken to mean anyone who carry out the mandates of a doctrine, since it means, amen, that anybody who is running behind a faith with a microphone and a podium, we got to define our faith. You have to make sure that you are in the right church. This word is for you to know, for you to examine from where you're sitting, from where you're standing, from where you're listening, to know if you are serving the right God. The sermon is for you to know, for you to examine, as Paul said, that you have to examine yourself to see if you are in the faith or not. You have to make sure you are serving the God, amen, the God of God, who is above all. There is no God that can be compared to our God, who made himself man to die for your sins. I'm coming to you today to present to you Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior of our soul. Watch this. So then, ladies and gentlemen, if the name of your God is Baal, you are serving the wrong God. If the name of your God is Dagon, the God of the Philistines, you are serving the wrong God. If the God you are serving is from Mecca, hallelujah, you are indeed serving the wrong God, and you are on the the wrong truck. But if you serve him, one that came down from heaven, and he went up back with a shout, you are serving now the right God. Not only that, ladies and gentlemen, it is important for you to prove the authenticity of your faith. And so as it is here, we have got to be on the same adlib or the same note, amen, that John the Baptist find himself on. He said, when I look around among this crowd, when I observe all the people that I came in contact with, this is the authentic God. He said, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away every sin. Not only the sin of you standing here, but he came to take the sins of Judea. He came to take the sin of Samaria. He came to take the sin of Jerusalem. He came to go to Jordan, Egypt, and everywhere, take it away the sins of the world. But he said, you got to understand for yourself who Jesus is. Jesus appearing to John before he was officially known and accepted by the people. He came as a simple humanitarian. Oh Lord, have mercy. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. You can't let our modernistic temple that we are putting up and that we're putting together, amen, come in the same level with Jesus. Oh yes, Christian, this message is to the heart of the Christian. This message is to the consciousness of the Christian. This message has to stay in the incubator of your mind, a place where you can develop, oh Lord, in the Word, a place where you can go to get stuff. Oh yes, and when Jesus, amen, came, he was a man dressed in simple attire. He wore a pants called chiton. Oh yes, sir. It was made out of special garment. So the chiton, amen, it have, oh yes, sir, sign of Persiana on it, that they might understand that the priest is with you. It was not ordinary, but extraordinary in that light. And then he wear an outer garment called hemitation, which is likened to a long robe or a coat. And on his feet, he has sandals on that was commonly worn by the simple people of that day. He appeared not as the King of Kings. He appeared not as God, but as a servant. He came to serve you dish. It's amazing when you go to a restaurant and you see the manager and you see the CEO serving meals. That was Jesus here. He came not as God, but he came as a servant. He was just in servitude robe. He came as a simple man to deliver a simple message. As many as they that have been baptized, oh Lord, if you baptize today in me, you have received me. You have received power. You have received deliverance. You have received all the healing and stuff you've been waiting on. Hey, yes, sir. He came here, amen, speaking in simple language. He didn't speak in any Queen's English. Jesus is not like any man that you have met. And Jesus, when John the Baptist saw him, he didn't come to put on anything. This is pathetically the Christ. He was in the Old Testament Christ before he came to the New Testament. Oh, will you hang with me here? And so and so and so, he didn't come here as somebody have a house in the hills of Jerusalem. Oh Lord of mercy. But he came here, Hatoshama, a man of sorrow. Oh Lord have mercy. When John the Baptist looked in his eyes, there was pain everywhere. When John the Baptist saw him, oh Lord, he saw a man that was, Lord, in sorrowful spirit. He came here. Amen. He was sorry for sin. Your sin had worried him out. Your sin has put him in depression. Your sin has put him in suspense. He didn't know how to get up out of it. And the Bible says, according to Isaiah's writing, in Isaiah 53, this is the prophecy. And Isaiah 53 said, this is a long way off, because Isaiah was not in his time, but he saw Jesus coming 400 years to come, and he began to prophesy about Jesus, and he asked a question in Isaiah 53. He said, who hath believed our report, and to whom the arm of the Lord reveal? For he shall go up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. Hallelujah, Jesus. So Jesus was planted, hallelujah, with us as a tender plant. He came on earth, amen, in the month of Abib, which is April, 4 BC, born of a damsel. They call her Mary, and not the mother Mary you read about, according to Catholicism. You'll just stay right there. And he grew up both with no form nor comeliness. And when he shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. Hallelujah, Jesus. He is despised and rejected of men. A man of sorrow and acquainted with grief. And he hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Hallelujah, Jesus. We have to understand that Jesus is dependent on you. Whether you are young or you are old, whether you are middle age or about to jump in, or you are about to faint, there is no retirement in Jesus. I heard pastors just over 50 talking about they retire from the gospel. You didn't come to Jesus because Methuselah lived 969 years and did not retire. They kept it going all the way to the end. Abraham kept it. Oh, after he buried his wife Sarah, he kept it going. He didn't give up. Jesus was quite explicit about the cause of discipleship. He was a lot concerned about those that was following him. Discipleship requires total commitment and a total committed life. You see, the Bible was speaking here about the scenario that Mary was paid to a wedding. Hallelujah, Jesus. You imagine, Rabbi, a teacher was sent from God who walked to Genesis. He walked to the Torah. He walked to the judges. He walked to the major prophets. He walked to the minor prophets. And he walked up, oh Lord, to the New Testament church as Jesus. Oh Lord, I feel like preaching. Woo! Lord, and here, as it was my Jesus. Amen. He came on the scene and found many people talking about Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Heard many people talking about God. And even Paul got mad when he saw the people was speaking about the unknown God. It is important for you to understand who he is. And say, Jesus, amen, as he in St. Matthew 4:18-22, it says here, and Jesus walked along the shores of the Lake Galilee. He saw two brothers who were fishermen. Yes, sir. Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew catching fish in the lake. Jesus said to them, come with me and I will teach you to catch people. I want you because I see your patience. Not many people understand what it is to be a fisherman. Sometimes you cast your net for a whole night and you catch nothing. Sometimes you think you're at the wrong sea because the sea is full with fishes. And all you do when you drop your bait, they eat the bait, but you still didn't catch no fish. But Jesus, he says, I kind of like the spirit of the fisherman, because when I came and I look around, I met the multitudes, and everybody looks like they have the ability to carry this gospel. To carry this gospel takes some denying. You're not going to carry the cross and still have business as usual. And the Bible says he went on and saw two other brothers, James and John, the sons of Zebedee. They were in their boat with their father Zebedee, getting their nets ready. They left their boat. Hallelujah. I said they left their boat. When they were called, nothing was too important to give up. When Jesus calls you, amen, there is no family that can stop you. When Jesus calls you, no money can stop you. No pretty car Jesus chose ordinary men who was poor and unschooled as a prime example of the type of qualities and qualification you need or it requires to follow him. Amen, sir. Discipleship is something here different. The man did not fit for the front line. Oh yes, sir. These fishermen, so to speak, they were not polished in their discourse. These fishermen, they were just simply focusing on their livelihood, families, and other personal identities. But following Jesus was simple because they did not have much to lose, and their earthly passion was not their main focus. Many people would not give up zealous to follow Jesus. You can't live or go sue across town. Oh Lord Jesus, to follow Jesus. And so we've got to go to party tonight. And when you leave girl Sue, then you take on Susan, and you find yourself, amen, a confused, amen, person walking around having various relationships. But when you get to Jesus, the rabbi, he will let everything fall in place. Oh Lord Jesus, according to a holistic study, hallelujah, I have read their viewpoint. It says if a rabbi approaches you, a Talmud, and said to him, follow me, it was a big deal because it meant that the rabbi believed that the potential Talmud had the ability and the commitment to become like him. So, ladies and gentlemen, when you visit the church that night and you said your heart was not right and something got a hold on you, it was Jesus. But when he now takes control of your heart and your mind, he wanted you to be a demonic Jesus. Cause some great works that I have done, greater works shall you do. I'm gonna make sure you have got what it takes. Gonna make sure you have the potential. And so these disciples, they follow Jesus, Eloshanda, everywhere. Hallelujah. And through their questions, oh, and all their discourse, and through their lifestyle, we can use, amen, the life of the disciples to perfect our walk with God. Oh, yes, sir. Some of the questions they ask is, what shall be the sign of thy coming? When shall be the end of the time? And if that didn't ask, we wouldn't have something to be measuring up to. Not only that, oh Lord Jesus, you see, although he had Peter as being the only spokesman, and although Judas Iscariot, amen, he was a great evangelist, he always liked to answer questions. Judas outbeats Peter. betrayed Jesus by selling him out. You see, you can't be in the church and love money. If you's come into the ministry for money, amen, you're going to drop out quickly. Because this is not about money. It is about saving of man's soul and calling man from sin to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. And when Peter, time was come, amen, he thought he would be able to carry on this gospel. But there came a time when there's got to be a systematic shift. The gospel is critical. When sometime you gotta step it up. No Hail Mary, Mother of Jesus, is going to do it. No calling and any emerging spirit is going to do it. You're going to need fellowship with Jesus. Oh, joy divine. You're going to be named Jesus only. It's going to be all about Jesus in order to carry this gospel. So the Bible says that there was a man up in Jerusalem. His name was Saul of Tarsus. And he was hunting and bounting. He was behaving belligerent. He was unhumbled, a great lawyer, sitting at the feet of Gamaliel, educated to the law. He was a chief man of the law. He understand how to walk in the law and keep the law blameless. He was dictatorial. He was exclusive. He knew it inside and out. And the Bible says, while he was on his way through Damascus Road to persecute the church, here comes Jesus. I'm going to catch another disciple. I'm going to turn this nigga around. I'm going to turn this one. Oh man, I'm going to make sure you don't kill no more body. I'm going to make sure you don't take nobody's life. I'm going to make sure you're going to walk with the script, not according to the legalistic movement, but you're going to be carrying the gospel of salvation to all the regions. Oh Lord, before the end come. And he was blinded and was given a word. He was sent to Cornelius. And when he was raised up with the Holy Ghost, Paul went everywhere preaching and teaching the gospel of the truth. Hallelujah. As it were, Jesus speaking through another scenario here that was recorded in the book of Luke, the only Gentile writer of the Bible. And Luke 14:16, then said he unto him, a certain man made great supper and bade many. He had invited many to his supper, and he sent servants, he sent disciples, amen, out to recruit people to the church. Many of you that are listening to my voice today, you are so busy, you can't pray no more. Hallelujah, Jesus. You can't find time for Jesus. Watch this. A lot of you ladies and gentlemen have spent thousands of dollars. You have been to the best negotiator around town in the real estate business, asking them to find you a crib uptown. I want a 5-bedroom house. Oh Lord, I want it with a den. Although it's just me and honey, we want this crib to have all kinds of stuff in it. Hallelujah. Some of you have houses that are 7- and 8-bedroom house. Lord have mercy. And you put in your refrigerator. Some of you have the technology where you can stay on your job and you can start your microwave and you can start your oven and you can do all kinds of different stuff. But you didn't build a little place. You didn't build a little corner, even with one chair, where you could kneel down before and pray. Isn't that a shame that you call yourself Christian and you never pray in your house? Oh Lord, you never keep a prayer meeting between you and your mistress. You never call your children to purr. Isn't that a shame? But Sunday morning you run the aisle. You jump on the pulpit and you preach. Oh Lord, who are you representing? Hallelujah. You need to get the spirit of the fisherman. You need to get the spirit of the one who called the fisherman. His name is Jesus. Yeshua. Oh Lord of hosts. The God who is with us. Hallelujah. Oh Lord, can I preach? And the Bible says, and they all with one consent begun to make excuse. One said, I have bought a piece of ground, but you didn't stop to thank God for the money to buy your ground. One said, he just married a wife. He don't have time for Jesus. But he don't understand, if Jesus don't step in your relationship, all you're going to have is relationship problems every day. If it's not this, it's that. Because God is not inside of your situation. But what is important here, Jesus told the disciples, the servants, he said, go tell these men and women that are bidden to my supper. Hallelujah. If they are not willing to give up mama, if they are not willing to give up their wives, if they are not willing to give up daddy, if they are not willing to give up their sons like Abraham, give up his son at the stake. Oh Lord, when the ram came running in and the boy said, daddy, there goes the sacrifice. Lord have mercy, you've got to be willing to give up something for God. And Jesus tell them, if you are not willing to give up everything you have to follow me, you cannot be my disciples. Discipleship is a relationship. When you have relationship with God, when you become a disciple, hallelujah, is facing you. Hallelujah. I know you may be feeling weak in your flesh. I know the feet feel like it can't make it up to church today. I know the back is a little bit weak because something is happening in my body. But Jesus said to tell you, Christian, my grace is sufficient for you. Hallelujah. You don't have to see it to touch it. You don't have to understand it to receive it. Hallelujah. My grace is sufficient for you. It's not about you. It's about my spirit. Because if the spirit of him that raised Jesus Christ from the dead, you see, if it dwells in you, if it dwells in you and you, if it dwells in you, yes, sir, it shall also quicken the mortal body. The mortal body won't stop, but the grace of God have a way to fulfill your wants and your needs. Amen. So, discipleship calls for an impartation. Hallelujah. It calls for a study. It calls for something to have this relationship. I don't care where you are in your life. You are a disciple because you are following somebody. He's been speaking to your mind day and night. Oh Lord, but your Bantam in Jamaica said, I had a close one yesterday. Just sent an angel over me. I feel like borrowing those words. There is sometimes, you know, you should have been dead. That close accident that you walk up out of, your car has been totaled, and you don't have a scratch on your body. So now you're browning and you look good. Now you're wearing some snakes. Now you're wearing sweet, nice suit. And you and your mistress is living it up. Don't you forget, the Bible says, beware lest thou forget where the Lord your God has taken you from. Cause the God who take you, hallelujah, 5 steps forward, has the power to reverse it and put you 10 steps backwards. Oh yes, sir. Discipleship, amen, requires discipline. Discipleship is an obligation. You've got to be under obligation. Discipleship is an urgent call that needs not to be questioned. Amen. So much wilderness wanderers who are wandering aimlessly and drifting down sin pathway. You can visit this church and you can visit that church, but there is one thing about it. You must fulfill the work of him that sent you while it is day. For the night cometh when no man shall work. Hallelujah, Jesus. And you can drift, but you don't have to drift anymore, because Jesus is here. He is here. Amen. In the saving business, Jesus, he is here for deliverance seekers. Jesus, he's here for truth seekers. The Bible says he is God with us. Oh Lord, he came even in his wings, he came as a lion and the lion, and the rose of Sharon. He came as the lily of the valley. In him we move and have our being. Hallelujah. You don't have to look any further. Jesus is in your midst. Today I present Jesus to you. Oh Lord, I'm proud to tell you of his wondrous works. How he has opened blinded eyes. How he has healed sick and raised the dead. Is anything impossible for God? Ain't there is nothing that is impossible with God. He is our all in all. A personal relationship with Jesus guarantees you, hallelujah, the Holy Spirit. It guarantees you power to keep you from day to day. Hallelujah, Jesus. That everywhere you go on your journey, he is there with you. It's time to quit entertaining tainted gospel. Lord have mercy. That is preached week by week preachers who are spreading lies, making people believe their own gospel. The gospel of corruption. Gospel that don't have saving ingredients. It's time for you to turn and quit from watered down religion where people want you, amen, to believe, amen, anything. But this is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Can I get a witness? Is anybody on the Lord's side? Acts 4 and 12 says, if an angel come down from heaven and preach any other gospel unto you, let him be accursed. This is the truth, and nothing else but the truth. So help me God. John said, I declare it. Paul said, I declare it. Luke said, I declare it. Peter declared it. James declared it. Zebedee declared it. Hallelujah. Nathaniel declared it. And all these men and women declare that Jesus Christ, that he is the Son of God, that he is the Savior of the world. Rest assured that there is no God like this God. May God bless you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Shall we stand? Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this word. I thank you for speaking to your people expressly. Today, Lord, go with us. Be our Savior. Be our God. Be our Lord. May the peace of God pass of all understanding. Help us to keep our minds stayed on you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. They left their boat. Hallelujah. I said they left their boat. When they were called, nothing was too important to give up. When Jesus calls you, amen, there is no family that can stop you. When Jesus calls you, no money can stop you. No pretty car, no job, nowhere can stop you when God called you. Call the gifts and calling of God is without repentance. God has been calling you. Oh yes, sir. You said to yourself you are not ready. You said to yourself you are not perfect. were just simply focusing on their livelihood, families, and other personal identities. But following Jesus was simple because they did not have much to lose, and their earthly passion was not their main focus. Many people would not give up zealous to follow Jesus. You can't live or go sue across town. Oh Lord Jesus, to follow Jesus. And so we've got to go to party tonight. And when you leave girl Sue, then you take on Susan, and you find yourself amen, a confused amen person walking around having various relationships. But when you get to Jesus, the rabbi, he will let everything fall in place. Oh Lord Jesus, according to a holistic study, hallelujah, I have read their viewpoint. It says if a rabbi approaches you, a Talmud, and said to him, follow me, it was a big deal because it meant that the rabbi believed that the potential Talmud had the ability and the commitment to become like him. So, ladies and gentlemen, when you visit the church that night and you said your heart was not right and something got a hold on you, it was Jesus. But when he now takes control of your heart and your mind, he wanted you to be a demic Jesus. Cause some great works that I have done, greater works shall you do. I'm gonna make sure you have got what it takes. Gonna make sure you have the potential. And so these disciples, they follow Jesus, Eloshanda, everywhere. Hallelujah. And through their questions, oh, and all their discourse, and through their lifestyle, we can use, amen, the life of the disciples to perfect our walk with God. Oh, yes, sir. Some of the questions they ask is, what shall be the sign of thy coming? When shall be the end of the time? And if that didn't ask, we wouldn't have something to be measuring up to. Not only that, oh Lord Jesus, you see, although he had Peter as being the only spokesman, and although Judas Iscariot, amen, he was a great evangelist, he always liked to answer questions. Judas outbeats Peter. He was so sanctimonious. He was so close to Jesus. Oh Lord of mercy. Judas was so popular that he became the bursar. He used to keep the monies for them. He was their main accountant. But it came to a point in a time when Judas betrayed Jesus by selling him out. You see, you can't be in the church and love money. If you's come into the ministry for money, amen, you're going to drop out quickly. Because this is not about money. It is about saving of man's soul and calling man from sin to God. Hallelujah. You're going to need fellowship with Jesus. Oh, joy divine. You're going to be named Jesus only. It's going to be all about Jesus in order to carry this gospel. So the Bible says that there was a man up in Jerusalem. His name was Saul of Tarsus, and he was hunting and bounting. He was behaving belligerent. He was unhumbled, a great lawyer, sit at the feet of Gamaliel, educated to the law. He was a chief man of the law. He understand how to walk in the law and keep the law blameless. He was dictatorial. He was exclusive. He knew it inside and out. And the Bible says, while he was on his way through Damascus Road to persecute the church, here comes Jesus. I'm going to catch another disciple. I'm going to turn this nigga around. I'm going to turn this one. Oh man, I'm going to make sure you don't kill no more body. I'm going to make sure you don't take nobody's life. I'm going to make sure you're going to walk with the script, not according to the legalistic movement, but you're going to be carrying the gospel of salvation to all the regions. Oh Lord, before the end come. And he was blinded and was given a word. He was sent to Cornelius, and when he was raised up with the Holy Ghost, Paul went everywhere preaching and teaching the gospel of the truth. Hallelujah. As it were, Jesus speaking through another scenario here that was recorded in the book of Luke, the only Gentile writer of the Bible. And Luke 14:16, then said he unto him, a certain man made great supper and bade many. He had invited many to his supper, and he sent servants, he sent disciples, amen, out to recruit people to the church. Many of you that are listening to my voice today, you are so busy, you can't pray no more. Hallelujah, Jesus. You can't find time for Jesus. Watch this. A lot of you ladies and gentlemen have spent thousands of dollars. You have been to the best negotiator around town in the real estate business, asking them to find you a crib uptown. I want a 5-bedroom house. Oh Lord, I want it with a den, although it's just me and honey. We want this crib to have all kinds of stuff in it. Hallelujah. Some of you have houses that are 7- and 8-bedroom house. Lord have mercy. And you put in your refrigerator. Some of you have the technology where you can stay on your job, and you can start your microwave, and you can start your oven, and you can do all kinds of different stuff. But you didn't build a little place. You didn't build a little corner, even with one chair, where you could kneel down before and pray. Isn't can never call your children to prayer is not a shame. But from the morning you run the aisle, you jump on the pulpit and you preach. Oh Lord, who are you representing? Hallelujah. You need to get the spirit of the fisherman. You need to get the spirit of the one who called the fisherman. His name is Jesus. Yeshua. Oh Lord of hosts. The God who is with us. Hallelujah. Oh Lord, can I preach? And the Bible says, and they all with one consent begun to make excuse. One said, I have bought a piece of ground, but you didn't stop to thank God for the money to buy you ground. One said, he just married a wife. He don't have time for Jesus. But he don't understand, if Jesus don't step in your relationship, all you're going to have is relationship problems every day. If it's not this, it's that. Because God is not inside of your situation. But what is important here, Jesus told the disciples, the servants, he said, go tell these men and women that are bidden to my supper. Hallelujah. If they are not willing to give up mama, if they are not willing to give up their wives, if they are not willing to give up daddy, if they are not willing to give up their sons like Abraham, give up his son at the stake. Oh Lord, when the ram came running in and the boy said, daddy, there goes the sacrifice. Lord have mercy, you've got to be willing to give up something for God. And Jesus tell them, if you are not willing to give up everything you have to follow me, you cannot be my disciples. Discipleship is a relationship. When you have relationship with God, when you become a disciple, hallelujah, Bible says, if you take up any deadly thing, it shall not hurt you. Can I preach? Oh Lord, when you become a friend of Jesus, you've got power over sickness. When you become a friend of Jesus, you've got power over every situation that is facing you. Hallelujah. I know you may be feeling weak in your flesh. I know the feet feel like it's going myself, but the grace of God have a way to fulfill your wants and your needs. Amen. So discipleship calls for an impartation. Hallelujah. It calls for a study. It calls for something to have this relationship. I don't care where you are in your life. You are a disciple because you are following somebody. He's been speaking to your mind day and night. Oh Lord, but your Banton in Jamaica said, I had a close one yesterday. Just send an angel over me. I feel like borrowing those words. There is sometimes, you know, you should have been dead. That close accident that you walk up out of, your car has been total, and you don't have a scratch on your body. So now you're browning and you look good. Now you're wearing some snakes. Now you're wearing sweet, nice suit. And you and your mistress is living it up. Don't you forget, the Bible says, beware lest thou forget where the Lord your God has taken you from. Cause the God who take you, hallelujah, 5 steps forward, has the power to reverse it and put you 10 steps backwards. Oh yes, sir. Discipleship, amen, requires discipline. Discipleship is an obligation. You've got to be under obligation. Discipleship is an urgent call that needs not to be questioned. Amen. So much wilderness wanderers who are wandering aimlessly and drifting down sin pathway. You can visit this church and you can visit that church, but there is one thing about it. You must fulfill the word of him that sent you while it is day. For the night cometh when no man shall work. Hallelujah, Jesus. And you can drift, but you don't have to drift anymore, because Jesus is here. He is here, amen, in the saving business. Jesus, he is here for deliverance seekers. Jesus, he's here for truth seekers. The Bible says he is God with us. Oh Lord, he came with healing in his wings. He came as a lion and the lion and the rose of Sharon. He came as the lily of the valley. In him we move and have our being. Hallelujah. You don't have to look any further. Jesus is in your midst. Today I present Jesus to you. Oh Lord, I'm proud to tell you of his wondrous works. How he has opened blinded eyes. How he has healed sick and raised the dead. Is anything impossible for God? Ain't there is nothing that is impossible with God. He is our all in all. A personal relationship with Jesus guarantees you, hallelujah, the Holy Spirit. It guarantees you you. It's time to quit entertaining tainted gospel. Lord have mercy. That is preached week by week preachers who are spreading lies, making people believe their own gospel. The gospel of corruption. Gospel that don't have saving ingredients. It's time for you to turn and quit from watered down religion where people want you, amen, to believe, amen, anything. But this is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Can I get a witness? Is anybody on the Lord's side? Acts 4 and 12 says, if an angel come down from heaven and preach any other gospel unto you, let him be accursed. This is the truth, and nothing else but the truth. So help me God. John said, I declare it. Paul said, I declare it. Luke said, I declare it. Peter declared it. James declared it. Zebedee declared it. Hallelujah. Nathaniel declared it. And all these men and women declare that Jesus Christ, that he is the Son of God, that he is the Savior of the world. Rest assured that there is no God like this God. May God bless you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Shall we stand? Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for this word. I thank you for speaking to your people expressly. Today, Lord, go with us. Be our Savior. Be our God. Be our Lord. May the peace of God that passeth all understanding help us to keep our minds stayed in you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.